Good morning. Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Chicago online worship. I am Grace Latabadere Williams, a member of this congregation. I serve on the Board of Trustees as Vice President, and I am Chair of our Good Relations Committee. I'm glad to serve as your worship associate today. We are a Unitarian Universalist congregation, a community of children, youth, and adults, a people of many beliefs and traditions, bound not by the specific list of things we believe, but the values we share and the mission to grow our souls and heal the world. Whether you are joining us for the first time or you've worshiped with us thousands of times, you are welcome here. Whether you believe in God some of the time, all of the time, or none of the time, you are welcome here. No matter how much money is in your pocket, no matter if you have a PhD, a GED, or no degree, you belong here. We are a people of many races and beliefs. We are a people of many genders and sexual orientations. All of you is sacred. All of you is welcome. You belong here. I invite you now to be present to this moment. Let us enter into this service together as the prelude begins.
I walk the unfrequented road with open eye and ear. I watch afield the farmer load the bounty of the year. I filch the fruit of no one's toil, no trespasser. Sheaf, the amber air, the rivers flow, the rustle of the leaf. A beauty springtime never knew on all the quiet ways, and sweeter shines the landscape through its veil.
The words for our chalice lighting come from Amy Brooks, The Persistent Flame. Even as the days grow shorter and our homes shrink smaller, and our wicks burn lower, and our will to endure flickers, we light this chalice to kindle a flame of warmth as a reminder of the connection that draws us in to a community that opens us up in gratitude for the breath in our lungs, and the love in our hearts, and for the gift of this day, alive. Come, let us worship. I invite you now to join in the reciting of our covenant.
The commitment that we make to each other about what it is we're doing here, why we gather, who we're becoming and who we are.
Love is the spirit of this church, and service is law. This is our great covenant.
To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
I invite you now to greet one another warmly. In the chat box of friendship.
Remembering it's public. Say hello.
Good morning. At this time, please gather those who are young and young at heart for a time for all ages. Thank you. This morning, as the world turns to its time of rest in the Midwest, we look at the art of slowing down ourselves. Think of the time that you spend with silence as a time to look inward. What does that inner voice say when you give yourself time to rest and listen? And where does that little murmur come from? We can think of attending to this as a form of prayer and reflection that can give extraordinary meaning to the moments in our lives. If you are joining us this morning, please enjoy some other highlights of these special moments of silence with The Quiet Book by Deborah Underwood and Renata Lewowski. As we read, think about these unique situations where we may give pause and how they give space for that small voice inside. The Quiet Book by Deborah Underwood and Renata Lewowski. There are many kinds of quiet. First one awake quiet. Oh man. Jelly side down quiet. Don't scare the robin quiet. Others telling secrets quiet. Coloring in the lines quiet. Thinking of a good reason that you were drawing on the wall quiet. Hide and seek quiet. And last one to get picked up from school quiet.
So we make under water quiet. pretending that you're invisible quiet?
Lollipop quiet.
First look at your new,
your new haircut. Quiet.
Sleeping sister, quiet.
Right before you yell, surprise! Quiet.
Making a wish.
Top of the roller coaster, quiet.
Best friends don't need to talk quiet. Surprise visit from Aunt Tilly, quiet. Do iguanas bite, quiet? Before the concert starts, quiet. Trying not to hiccup. Quiet. The first snowfall, quiet. Car ride at night, quiet.
Too many bubbles, quiet.
Story time, quiet. Tucking in teddy bear, quiet. Bedtime kiss, quiet.
Whoa! More flashlight,
quiet. Sound asleep, quiet. And end of story, quiet.
Before we part this morning, I wanted to enjoy a few moments of silence together. We're going to be using this, a home and sphere, as our guide. As I bring it out, you're going to take a big, deep belly breath in. And as I bring it back in, you're slowly going to let that breath out. Ready? Let's begin. Nice work. Thanks very much.
I didn't grow up praying. We didn't say prayers before bedtime or around the dinner table. And as a result, I absorbed an impression of prayer that was cobbled together from movies and TV shows and pop culture. I cobbled together the childhood atheist understanding of prayer, that it was a sort of a cosmic bargain, that you were asking for a thing which surely then would come or not, all of which seemed preposterous to me. For me, part of the work of adult spiritual practice has been to try and learn this language that I never learned as a child, to try to learn what it really is. The same as the person who, never tries Indian food because they don't like it, but actually they've never tried it, so they don't know what it's all about. For me, learning this language has in part been about reminding and recalling and remembering who I am and what I'm about. That in saying the names of the people that I care for and worry over, I call them to mind, I bring them back to consciousness, and that changes me into the sort of person who cares about other people and thinks on them and sends my care and my worry their way. It changes me, whatever it does to the world beyond me. Part of what prayer does is to help recenter me in the reality that's so much larger than our understanding. It helps remind me that the world that I move through day to day, the world of hard edges, of to-do lists, of voicemail that needs to be answered, an email that only ever grows larger, that this is just a tiny, tiny slice of experience. And in prayer, in redirecting myself to my own understanding of what this larger thing is, this larger life that we move through, that changes me into a person who remembers that on a regular basis and lives as if that's the case, best I can, more or less. Friends, this is the time in the service each week that we invite you into a spirit of prayer and meditation. Will you join with me in that? Settle your body down wherever you are. Let it relax. Let yourself be held by the earth, by the chair, by the floor, by the couch. Let yourself settle internally too. Take a breath with me. And let that inner self gentle just a little bit. Another breath. In this moment, we direct our hearts, our minds, our spirit inward or maybe outward to that sense, to that experience that we understand by so many names and different ways that we call God, that we call the spirit of life, that we call just coming into awareness of the world as it is. That power greater than ourselves, which reminds us that whoever and whatever is in charge or not, it certainly isn't us. Into the presence of that we come in this moment. And whatever that hidden inner door of the spirit is that opens you to that experience, I invite you now to open that door. We hold in our hearts parents and teachers, and all those whose primary spiritual practice of compassion and patience and resilience is caring for children. We are with you. We pray, we hope, we remember those who live with grief, who live with chronic pain, with mental disability, with addiction, illnesses and wounds, seen and unseen. We're with you. For our neighbors in prison, you are not forgotten. For those who care for family in ill health, for those who are struggling to stay afloat in the midst of poverty, we are with you. You're not invisible. You're not gone. You're right here. Our lives are blessed by those who knowingly and with curiosity and courage face their final days. They too are us, and we are with you, and all of us held in a love far beyond what we know. We move through this life trying to let go and set down that impulse that's in us, that's in all of us, to power through and push through this thing alone. We gather in this hour, each of us behind screens and phones and computers and TVs, in part because what we are trying to do, each of us in our own way, is come into the world and be people among people. And in that spirit, I invite you, as the music begins in the chat, to share a joy or a sorrow. Share something heavy on your heart. Share something that lifts you up. Share how things are for you so that you don't have to go it alone. and cast all of those hopes and fears and worries and concerns and cares and joys out into this gathered community. Amen.
Pray as you can, not as you can't, by Marcus Braybrook. There are hundreds of definitions of prayer, and there is no right way to pray. As an old adage put it, pray as you can, not as you can't. The first step in learning to pray is to free ourselves from preconceptions of what prayer is. Perhaps childhood memories of being forced to say prayers have put us off for years. We may not believe in God, or we may doubt whether prayer has any effect. It's important not to feel anxious about such thoughts. They need not prevent us from finding our own way of praying. And they often fade as we discover the peace that prayer can bring. We should never be discouraged from embarking on our adventure. We are never too young or too old to benefit from learning to pray. The second step on the road to prayer is to forget any fixed ideas we have about how to pray. We do not need to worry whether we use words or keep quiet, whether we kneel down or sit or stand, whether we place our hands together or hold prayer beads. We can pray at any time, anywhere, in any way. The only prerequisite for prayer is that we be ourselves.
Welcome to our third installment in our series on spiritual practices you can do at home. Today, we'll be exploring practices of prayer. Over the course of the pandemic, when we cannot worship together in person, we gather online together, connected through cyberspace, through our screens, through a series of ones and zeros going up to space and back together again. And we are here with one another. We are forced to separate, and yet we have an interesting opportunity. In quarantine, we can begin to cultivate spiritual practices in the comfort and isolation at times of our own home, when under other circumstances, we might not take the time to do so. Spiritual practice is done best over time, like exercise. You can start exercising and lifting weights, moving your body, getting your heart and lungs stronger. And if you do it once, the first time, quite honestly, may not be fun. It may feel really foreign, awkward, and uncomfortable. Or maybe it feels good to move your body, and it's just kind of an isolated event. And the next time, you just feel like, I'm kind of tired. I don't want to do that. But like a musical instrument, or like exercise, spiritual exercises serve us best when we develop those skills regularly
over time. With a musical instrument, you could dabble every so often when you feel like it, and you could make noise. Or you could practice regularly and be able to make music. Similarly, here in this exercise space I have during quarantine in the bell tower, if I came a couple times a month, that might be nice, but I wouldn't really grow stronger and find joy in my body. It's when I go daily that through moving my body, I also move my spirit. So it is with spiritual practices. We started our spiritual practices series with altar building earlier this fall, and then by our shoot-ministerial intern who led us through Lectio Divina. And today, our third part in the series is prayer. In our tradition, we associate prayer with formal language in the middle of our church service, in our neo-Gothic space with a 50-foot vaulted ceiling and a rose window. Often we come to church dressed in nice clothes. We come from a tradition in which it is often true that people want to wear their Sunday best to church. So praying outside of that context may feel a little foreign to us. We need not be in a separate sanctified space or the physical space of our church building. We can be right in our very own home in any room that we feel comfortable in. We do not need to be wearing our Sunday best or whatever clothes we feel most comfortable coming to church in on Sunday. We can be in our pajamas or our workout clothes, whichever feels like gives our body the movement and expression. The most important thing is to be who you are, where you are, now. So let us enter together into a workshop on prayer. Our workshop today will be based on the work of colleague Reverend Eric Walker Wickstrom, who wrote the book Simply Pray. He is also featured in the book Everyday Spiritual Practices by Scott Alexander, contributing the chapter on prayer. Eric will walk us through building prayer beads in a way that is accessible for every Unitarian Universalist of any kind of theology, orientation, or belief. I hope you'll come along and join me. This first time, kind of like a cooking show, you can watch me assemble these prayer beads and talk you through it. And then I'll go through it once on my own for you. And then this video will remain up for viewing later, both in the context of this whole worship and as a standalone video in our spiritual practice playlist here on our YouTube channel. So if you'd like to make your own, you can then purchase the beads, see the comments, and they'll tell you exactly what you need to find around the house or to purchase online for just a couple of dollars. And then you too can make your very own prayer beads for this practice, which I hope you will find an enriching way to balance out, grow, and develop your spiritual practice in a time that is offering us many challenges, but also some opportunities. And with these beads, we'll pace our way one by one, hope by hope, articulate our needs and vulnerabilities, just like we'd be lifting weights, strengthening our muscles. We can strengthen our spirits.
For today's workshop on prayer, we will be exploring prayer beads in a practice developed by UU minister, the Reverend Eric Walker Wickstrom. Prayer beads of various kinds are used around the world as a tactile tool for repetitive prayers because they anchor us in a way that we can get out of our head. You might have seen the 108 bead malas of Buddhism. Here's an example with wooden beads along with various anchor points in the practice. Here is a different kind of bead, and this is for a consistent repetitive without any breaks in this particular practice. You might also think of the Rosary of Catholicism. With prayer beads, you don't have to concentrate on where you are because the beads give you cues. This is a way to get out of our thinking mind and to create space for our creative and spiritual capacities and wisdom to start to take root and to flourish. So think of today kind of like a cooking show. I'm going to lead you through how to make prayer beads and how to use them in this format that Reverend Eric developed. Prayer can be made more accessible when we focus on how rather than why or to whom. We often get caught up in all of the questions we have, but then never actually try and practice. If we flip the order and start to do our spiritual practice, then we might find that we consider the questions very differently, and we might find that the questions that are most important to us may not be the questions that we started with. Different people have different experiences of prayer and different ideas about what it is. For some people, it's a conversation with the divine, and for many of us, thinking in traditional language, that might be what comes to mind. For other people, it's an internal dialogue. For others yet, it's calming and centering. And whatever prayer may be or may not be, what it might do or not do to whom or to no one that it is addressed, we know one thing, is that prayer changes us, the one doing the praying. If the word prayer seems foreign or off-putting to you, think of it as a form of reflection. In the Christian tradition, there are four kinds of prayers. This is echoed through different world traditions in different ways. They are praise and thanksgiving, which Reverend Eric calls naming, and I like to call it saying hi and thank you. Intercession, which Reverend Eric says is loving. This is when we think of others. Confession, which is knowing or reflecting honestly on ourselves, warts and all. And contemplation, which is listening, quieting the mind and seeing what happens. For this prayer bead practice, you'll make your own prayer beads. You'll be able to see what I do here with this little prayer bead strand that I made following Reverend Eric's directions. And if you would like to do that, you can look in the description of today's videos. And what you'll need is one large bead, four medium beads, and 23 small beads, and the cord to string them on. So after you see this today, you may wish to come back to this video as part of this worship service, or in our spiritual practice playlist here on our YouTube channel, where you'll find just this segment where you can follow along as you assemble your own. Think of this as a cooking show where we're making lasagna. Everyone's going to have a casserole, and there's going to be some basic components, and we're going to make layers, but you get to choose the exact ingredients, you get to choose the seasonings, and you get to choose the context and how you wish to enjoy it. Made just for you. So centering is the large bead that we start with. This is like what we do in our church prayer when we invite you into a spirit of prayer and meditation and ask you to take a few deep breaths to be here and to be now. So in the centering part of this prayer practice, you breathe in and out several times. Calm the body and mind. Make your exhales longer than your inhales. This stimulates the parasympathetic nervous system, which calms your body. So we breathe. You can linger here as long as you like on this large bead as your time to center. Then just like exercise and just like cooking where you would set out your ingredients or you would start with some stretching, we have a warm-up of four small beads. So the next beads you would string are these four. And you can use them in a different way each time or with different seasons of your life and spirit. You could use a stanza of a poem, one stanza for each bead. You could do a hymn verse for each bead. You could also make each bead a deep breath. So for the first medium bead, this would be naming. These are traditionally known the prayers of praise and thanksgiving. I like to call them saying hi and thank you. So here, you'd name the holy and the things you are thankful for. So for some people, they like to imagine a higher power that is personal. And in a lot of traditional theological language, this is the case. The Islamic tradition has 99 names for God. Baha'i prayers have long lists of names of God in which the entire prayer is names of God. Hebrew scriptures have many as well, and so does Christianity. Pantheons of gods and goddesses throughout world indigenous traditions, Mother Nature. For some people, they like to call upon wise people, humanitarians, the human spirit, or the ancestors, or the communion of saints. You can also make up your own. One of my favorites for naming is the force that makes the roots go down and the leaves go up. We know a lot about it, but we don't really know what makes that happen, and I find that really sacred. Many people don't wish to imagine the divine as personal, or that's not how they experience it. So you can think of attributes you might ascribe to the sacred, or simply something bigger than yourself, something that feeds your soul. It could be joy, life force, the breath, the love of humankind, the interconnected web, the cosmos. So whatever that thing is that you're going to say hi to, then lift up some thanks. Things you're grateful for, large or small, serious or silly. Spiritual wisdom and psychology studies show significant changes in our mental health, our outlook, and behavior when we cultivate and name gratitude. And when we change ourselves, we start to change how we're interacting with our world and with other people. And that can dramatically change and impact the lives of those around us and our own. Between each medium bead, there are five small beads, which are a breath prayer. Think of this as a space in between each landmark where you're going to move out of your thinking brain and into a meditative state. If you were singing a song, this would be the chorus you would come back to. But after each new verse, there's another layer to it that's richer and deeper, but also a comfort of landing back in something familiar. Or if you're thinking back to the lasagna, think about these five beads as your next layer of lasagna noodles. So you can decide how you focus on your breath or a phrase. It's a two-line phrase that can be said in rhythm with your breath or five deep breaths. I like to do the meditation on breathing, the one of the hymns in our teal hymnal. So for each bead, when I breathe in peace. Bead two. When I breathe out love. Bead three. When I breathe in peace. Bead four. When I breathe out love. May it be so. And amen. Bead five. The second medium bead is knowing, or in traditional language, confession. This is about knowing yourself. Reflect on your life as it is today. What places call for reconciliation or atonement? Those are traditional language that may or may not speak to you, or you can reclaim. It's really about finding, is there a nagging sense in your heart of something that needs your attention? Or is it just something feeling off that you're unsettled by? This is not about guilt, shame, or self-criticism, but honest self-appraisal, akin to the searching and fearless moral inventory in the 12-step program. It's about knowing and accepting ourselves, warts and all, and loving ourselves enough that we won't let ourselves stay that way. It's about living into a bigger, more robust way of life. You can spend as long of time thinking in language or in feelings, in word and sound or silence on this bead, and then you move to your next five small beads. That's your anchor. That's the next lasagna noodle. And in my practice here, it's the meditation on breathing. When I breathe in peace. So on and so forth, like the chorus of your song. The third medium bead, then, is listening. In a traditional theological language, this is contemplative prayer. This is a place for revelation and not discourse. This is for listening rather than speaking, wisdom rather than knowledge, and silence rather than sound. So in this period, I invite you to just linger and settle in and see what may come. Sometimes it may feel empty and like there's nothing happening. But think of fall and winter on the prairie. What looks bleak and desolate, there is a tremendous network of activity going on underneath the soil, even in what seems to be the dead of winter. If you stick with your practice, you'll find at other times in the contemplation moment of your practice, it will bear rich fruits and you may be surprised with what comes to you. Stick with it. So then again, we have our five small beads. We come back to our chorus. Layer that next lasagna noodle, whatever metaphor works for you. In my version, I'll do the breathing, the meditation on breathing. When I breathe in peace. and do that for my five beats. That allows me to kind of sink in, let that previous reflection integrate into my mind and spirit, as well as a kind of a palate cleanser before my next stage of reflection. So the fourth medium beat is loving. This would be known as intercession or prayers of the people in some tradition. In our tradition, every Sunday, we offer up a space to lift up the names of anyone who you may hold in your heart that you wish to hold in the love of this community. And so we do that by speaking names aloud or holding them in the silence of our hearts. In virtual worship during this pandemic, you can type that into the chat box. And you can do this as well in our private prayer practice. Because prayer practice that only focuses on oneself becomes too narrow. But when we open up to others, then that creates more expansiveness in our heart. In the same way we stretch our muscles for exercise, it practices the skills of empathy. Reverend Eric said someone once asked why people had to pray to God since God knows all things and should already know about the needs of everyone. Some kind of traditional thoughts about an omnipotent God. And the wise one responds, we do not pray so God knows about people's needs. We pray to make sure we know. And that changes us. So I invite you on this fourth medium bead to bring people and things and situation and living creatures compassion, bring them to your consciousness, your awareness. I like to think of these in concentric circles, starting with those nearest to me in my household, and then extended family and friends, colleagues and acquaintances, and then those by region, by country, and by planet. Now, as we warmed up with four small beads, we'll cool down with four small beads. Just like in a workout, you take time to stretch and bring your heart rate down. Or like cooking, there is a time of integration and cleaning up when the meal is done. Again, these four beads can be a stanzas of a poem or a deep breath or a hymn verse. You may wish to make them the same as your opening four, so that you have some closure coming back to the place you started. Or you may find you have four phrases or stanzas at the beginning that are different than the ones at the end. You get to customize this and make it for you. I like to do voice still and small at the beginning and at the end. And I find that when I come back to the place I started, it now has more layers and richness for having completed this journey through these four anchor points of traditional prayers, broken open in a new way beyond perhaps the constraints we assign to traditional language that can be accessible to everyone. So it's centering. Say hi and say thank you. Knowing or confession, listening or contemplative prayer, loving or intercessory prayer, and then your cool down. This prayer practice you can do in maybe 15 or 20 minutes, or really treat yourself to a longer period like an hour. Maybe you do it for just a small bit of time. You keep your prayer beads in a pocket or a purse. And when you find yourself in line during the pandemic waiting to get into a grocery store or perhaps waiting for a Zoom meeting to start as those technical difficulties are ironed out and everyone comes to join the meeting, you might be able to just work through your prayer beads in your hand. This is a lovely size to hold. It feels pleasant. And you can decide what size of beads and constellation and colors would be most suitable for you. You want beads that are different enough in size and texture that you've got that tactile reminder so that you can really free up your heart and your mind to be thinking in your prayers without having to do too much work of remembering exactly where you are. Let these beads do that work for you. Prayer beads are just one of many, many ways of prayer and spiritual practice. And we could say that there are as many forms of prayer as there are people, and maybe even more, because every time we sit down to pray, we come at it in a different way and as a different person who has that much more lived experience since the last time we set ourselves to the task. I hope that you'll be able to come back to this video and assemble your own prayer beads. You'll need one large bead, four medium beads, 23 small beads, and a cord. And you may find that with some practice, this becomes a lovely tool and gift that you can give yourself in deepening your spirit in a time when we can't be together in our church building, but we can together build our spiritual practices.
Thank you so much for spending your morning with us worshiping here at the First Unitarian Church of Chicago. We are so grateful for this community and for the many hands and many hearts who have worked together to make this service possible. We are also so grateful and excited about the continued ministry that our church is doing beyond its walls and in this virtual space. There are many ways that you can get involved, whether it be joining a committee, volunteering for any aspect of our church life, or by participating with our offertory and giving a one-time donation to the church or a pledge. You can do so online or via text. The information will be on the next screen. Thank you so much for the sacred time with you this morning, and we look forward to having you tune in next week for another worship service with this wonderful, gracious community.